mainly taking out issues for discussion. Of course, there can't be any discussion, but yes, at least some food for thought, which I have in my mind, I'll pass it on to you people. And if anybody has any of the points to discuss, as is the rule, it will be taken up at the end of the session, right? If time permits. Now, straight away, I will go to the points which I want to discuss. And okay, just 1 minute. Is everyone able to see the PPT now? Hello?
Yes, we can see.
Okay. Right. So, what I'm going to cover today is a brief introduction of exports under GST and refunds under GST. Then we'll take up some issues in exports. Okay. Then we'll take procedural issues in refund and then the legal issues in refund, which I've bifurcated the refund issues into procedural and legal for the sake of convenience. All issues are equally important. However, just to give a better understanding and a break to concentrate more on the legal issues. Right. Coming to the introduction part. Now, see, GST is a mixture of VAT, service tax, and excise. If I may speak jokingly, whatever is worst of this act have been incorporated into GST rather than the best part. For example, exports, one of the crucial areas when the Indian government is promoting or saying go local, vocal is local. So in these scenarios, exports have to be made very friendly to the industry in such a way that people are aggravated, or rather they are incentivized to go into more and more exports of goods from India. However, it is my personal opinion that exports is not as simplified as it was under VAT structure, because the exports under GST is mainly taken from the excise point of view. Exports under VAT was very simple, no tax on exports, and whatever was the ITC at the end of the year was automatically claimed as refund. But as far as GST is concerned, it is not the case. Exports under GST is under two criteria. One is on payment of IGST, where you have to make the payment and then claim the refunds, which comes from the customs department. And another is exports under bond, where you have to claim the refund of ITC, unutilized ITC, in your interest ledger. Now, going through this provisions of the Act, when we are talking about Section 54, which is refund, then talking about Section 16 of the... Okay, right. And before I go into the Section 54, Section 16 of the IGST Act is very important, because that says that exports under GST is not treated as exempt. It is treated as zero rated. Now, there's a difference between an exempt supply and a zero rated supply. Zero rated supply is nothing but a rate of zero is applied. Now, people who have dealt with Gujarat VAT Act will be more familiar with this concept, because there, under VAT itself, there was a concept of exempt supply and a zero rated supply. And supplies to SZ was considered zero rated in Gujarat VAT Act. So similarly, over here in GST, zero rated supply, exports are deemed to be zero rated supplies. Now, supplies to SEZ units are also deemed to be zero rated supplies. Now, this is very useful provision, because normally exports, if you go by the definition, it says export means taking goods from India to a place outside India. In case of supply to SEZ, it does not happen. Still, they wanted to give benefits to supplies made to SEZ unit, and therefore, when they coined this term of zero rated supply, everything is taken into consideration, and therefore there is no need for exempting the supplies to SEZ unit and no special treatment to SEZ supplies. It brings it on the same footing as the export supplies. So going by this, under GST, supplies made exports of goods and services is treated as zero debt supply, and supplies made to an SEZ developer or a unit is also treated as a zero debt supply. So that is one part of it. Now coming to section 54 after this. Section 54 is the it does not have many subsections. Okay, it's however, it is mainly a provision under which refunds have been more and more made intricate issues as part of sub delegation. For example, section 54 lays down the broad concept of refund. It will say when a refund is to be provided, within what time a refund is to be provided. Within which time the refund application has to be made, what refunds will be available, of what amounts. All those things have been broadly clarified in section 54. That's the provision main section. But when it comes to intricate issues, that the working of the refunds and everything has been sub-delegated into the rules. Now, to an extent, there is an over-delegation of certain things, which I'll point out when we go through the issues, which may arise to a lot of litigation. Instead of reducing the litigation, this may actually bring more and more litigation into picture. So section 54 is the refund of refund provision under section under the GST provisions. Now straight away I'll go to issues which we are facing in exports, right? And when we talk about issues in exports, Vinod ji, sabko mute kar dijiye na. Continuous disturbance aa raha hai.
Rahul, unmute yourself.
Vinod, on entry mute nahi karta yenar ka, karan te entry zalyavarti
kele mi kele tas. Yes. Rahul, unmute yourself. Ho gaya. Yeah, please carry on. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, it is coming up now.
Yeah.
Yes. So when it comes to issues in exports, one of the most burning issue which we are facing in exports is nothing but whether intermediary services qualify as export. Now, why this is a burning issue? There are a number of things I'll discuss in 2-3 slides ahead. Okay, let us first see what is the definition of intermediary service, which is defined in the IGST Act. Intermediary service means a broker, an agent, or any other person. Now, this any other person has to be read as in conjunction with a broker or an agent. So, any person in the nature of a broker or an agent, by whatever name called, who arranges or facilitates the supply of goods or services or both, or securities, between two or more persons, but does not include a person who supplies such goods or services or both on his own account. So in simple terms, we can break it down into four lines. Intermediary service provider is nothing but a broker or an agent or any other person in the nature of broker or an agent. He facilitates or arranges the supply of goods or services. He does this arrangement or facilitates between two or more persons, okay? And he does not provide or supply these goods or services on his own account. Then he is an intermediary service provider. Now, section 13B, 8B, which is for determining the place of supply. Section 13 is for determining place of supply of services in case where either the recipient or the service provider, supplier, is located outside India. In case of intermediary service being provided to a person outside India, the recipient is located outside India. Therefore, section 13 will be triggered. Subsection 8 specifically says that instead of the location of the recipient, the place of supply shall be the place as prescribed in the subsection 8. In clause B, in case of intermediary, the place of supply is prescribed as the location of the supplier himself. As a result, suppose I am a commission agent. I have a customer, I have a client in America. He wants to buy milk from India. I go and buy, find milk producers in India and give the contacts to him, against which he gives me commission, then in that case, I am providing service to the American client, but since it is the place of supply is within India, it does not fall under the export of services as defined in the IGST Act. And therefore, I am liable to pay CGST plus SGST in India itself. Export of service is defined. There are four conditions. One is supply is located in India, recipient is located outside India, place of supply is outside India, and the there should be a foreign convertible foreign currency as consideration. So in this case, since place of supply is not in India, is India itself, not outside India, therefore it will be a local supply liable to CGST plus SGST. Now, one of the important AIRs which came in this respect was the VServe Global Private Limited, one of the first AIRs on this topic also. In this case, VServe Global was providing back office support to its foreign clients, basically their sister concerns mainly. And they were doing various things like taking sales orders, documenting it, taking purchase orders, documenting it, then assisting in delivery, knowing whether it is delivered or not, when the transportation move and all those things. So this particular transaction which we are carrying out, they filed an application whether this will fall under intermediary service. The Maharashtra Advance Ruling Authority held that this is nothing but an intermediary service and liable to CGST and SGST and will not qualify as export of service. Now, this was further upheld by the Appellate Authority for Advance Ruling in Maharashtra. Now, this question of whether this back office services which are provided from India did qualify as intermediary service or not was a huge question. Because of this VServe Global, many across India were facing problems that they will not qualify under export of services. The very purpose of setting up companies in India for providing this kind of services will come into existential question, whether to exist, whether this company should exist or not. And therefore, representations were made. The CBIC in July 2019 had issued one circular number 107, dated 18 July 2019. In that circular, they sought to clarify IT-enabled services, whether they fall under intermediary services or not. In that circular, they had classified the transactions into three categories. First category was, if anybody wants to see, I can show that. Right. So this was the circular. So there was three scenarios. The first scenario was where the supplier provides back-end services, which are specified in this para 4. These are the services which we are referring to: payroll, remote maintenance, revenue accounting, support centers, website services, and all those things, legal databases, back office operations and all. So in scenario 1, they said that where the services are provided.
Unmuted.
This where the supplier provides all of the services on his own account, then it will not fall under the ambit of intermediary services. So when VServe Global, let's say, is providing this back-end services, back office operations from its on his own account, this will not fall under intermediary services. Then they took up scenario 2. However, when the supplier of backend services locally arranges or facilitates the supply of those services mentioned in para 4 of the circular, then it will be an intermediary services. Now, this will include and not limited to support services during pre-delivery, delivery and post-delivery of supply. Then it includes obtaining relevant government clearances, transportation of goods, post-sale support and other services. So, this was the second scenario which they talk about. This, they say, that will fall under intermediary service. And then it is scenario 3, where it is combination of both. Part of the service, the supplier provides from his own account. And part of the service, he is facilitating or arranging or sourcing it for the customer, the client. in that case, again, the circular said that we have to go into facts and circumstances of each case, and then only it can be determined whether it is in intermediary services or a main supply. Now, this was the circular. Now, this circular has actually created a lot of doubt. And this has, instead of clarifying, cluttered the entire transaction and made it more confusing. And therefore, the CBIC, while their subsequent circular dated 4th December 2019, circular number 127 of 2019, dated 4/12/2019, they withdrew this entire circular of July 2019. So now, as on date, whatever circular the CBIC had issued, clarifying or bifurcating the intermediary services and backend operations into three scenarios, have been withdrawn. Now let us see that similar provisions, because intermediary services is nothing new. It has been in the Indian law since 2012 when the negative list came into service tax. There again, they had place of provision, POPS rules, that is place of provision of service rules. And in that also, intermediary services was defined. Again, there also where the intermediary services provided to a service recipient outside India, but consumed in India, it was taxed as liable to service tax in India. There, GoDaddy, there is one particular advanced ruling under the service tax law. Now, there's a huge difference of an advanced ruling under GST law and an advanced ruling under service tax law. In case of GST advance ruling, the advance ruling is presided over by two officers, one from the central and one from the state. Both are joint commissioner level officers. But as far as advance ruling under service tax law is concerned, it was before the authority sitting in Delhi, which was presided over by a retired Supreme Court judge. Along with him, two judges were either from the judiciary or from the law department. So therefore, there's a vast difference as far as quality of advance ruling is concerned when we talk about service tax rulings and the GST rulings. Now, this GoDaddy India Web Services Private Limited is an advance ruling under the service tax law by the authority sitting in Delhi. There again, the question raised was, GoDaddy India was providing services to GoDaddy USA. And these services were in the nature of relating to marketing, branding, offline marketing, oversight of quality of third-party customer care center, and payment processing. We are dealing with payment processing also in this. And in this scenario, the question was raised whether this is an intermediary service or an export of service from India. The advance ruling authority under service tax held all these activities are on principle-to-principle basis with the sole intention of promoting the brand GoDaddy US in India and thus augmenting its business in India and does not qualify as intermediary service. In fact, they held that not every service can be intermediary services. We have to see that first of all, there's a principal and agent relationship which is established between the service provider and the service recipient. Only then we can see whether it's an intermediary service or not. Where it is on principle to principle basis, it cannot be considered as an intermediary service. So this is one of the advanced rulings which lay down the principles on intermediary service in very detailed manner. A beautiful advanced ruling, in fact. We can go through that. Thereafter, therefore, what I'm trying to say is that this concept of intermediary services in VSERF Global, where it is held that even giving your payment processing and all those services, whether it is an intermediary service or not, I think it is much better explained in this service tax advance ruling and should not be considered an intermediary service because these are not in the nature of principal and agent. These are in the nature of principle to principle, where the service provider is providing the services on his own account. Is not merely a facilitator and or arranging the services. In this advance ruling of GoDaddy, the one more point which can be noted is there again, along with the main service of marketing, there were various other ancillary services which were not provided by GoDaddy India to GoDaddy USA on his own account. But it were arranged for GoDaddy USA. There again, the service tax advance ruling authority held that these are all bundled services and composite service and hence will not still be considered as intermediary, will fall under the individual business support service. not as an intermediary service, but as business support service. So therefore, this one advanced ruling is very good, and we can go through this to get a little more clarity on this issue. The second advanced ruling which we have, which I consider is of West Bengal, which is a recent advanced ruling, 2018, under GST. Now, in this advanced ruling, now this is directly against GoDaddy, if we talk in simple terms. In this, West Bengal AR holds that promoting and marketing foreign university courses in India and recruiting prospective students for such courses in India is an intermediary service. What happens is, the foreign universities have various agencies, or various agencies in loose terms. We have to see whether a principal agent relationship is actually established, even though it is called an agency. These agencies actually promote various courses of US universities or UK universities or various German universities and so on and so forth. Along with this promotion, what they actually do is they consult the students, whoever wants to study abroad, and they show them various paths, various courses which are available in their interested field. Along with this, they also aid in getting the admissions in those universities. Once an admission is done, the foreign universities give commissions to these agencies established in India. The West Bengal AR says that this provision of services, that is promoting and marketing of foreign universities in India and recruiting prospective students for commission, is an intermediary services. Now, I think this particular advancement, if you compare it with GoDaddy, is in direct contradiction. And only courts will tell in future courts which one is the better advanced ruling or which one will prevail. But I'm just pointing out the two contradictory advanced rulings. So when it comes to intermediary service, it is actually a tricky subject. There is no foolproof answer as on date. Okay, and many times we have seen that the clients also, for example, let's say one of the clients approached me. So what they said is, they are an Indian subsidiary of a Dubai-based company. What they do is, they Dubai-based company is procuring goods from Indian manufacturers. This Indian subsidiary does nothing but ensures that all the manufacturing items which are going to Dubai from the local manufacturer in India are of proper quality and so on and so forth. And therefore, they are receiving certain fees for that. If we see this transaction loosely, it will not appear as an intermediary services. But when I go into the depth of it, I ask them, okay, what is the quality which you certify? Is there any certificate for it? Are you authorized to certify for this quality? Is there any provision under the law which requires this quality to be certified of certain category and so on and so forth? They were not able to answer it properly. So what I'm trying to say is, some people in India may want to disguise a particular intermediary service as a service provided on his own account. I think this kind of transactions have to be looked into twice before taking any decision, because there's a huge liability impact in future, and major kind of litigation will, as far as exports is concerned, will fall under the category of intermediary service only, in my view. And therefore, these transactions have to be looked into properly, documented, and see the actual nature of transaction. Only then intermediary services can be identified, and whether it's export or not will depend definitely on the identification of the intermediary service. Now, so this, I think this is one of the major issues I was taking. Let's go to the next issue, which is whether supply of goods to foreign customer but delivered to India party would qualify as exports. Now, this is again an issue which we recently discussed. We were discussing in our group, internal reading group. So what I'm trying to point out the issue over here is, exports has been defined. It means taking of goods out of India to a place outside India. So therefore, it is related to movement. If I take the goods outside India, it will be exports. If I don't take the goods outside India, it will not be exports. Only if it is exports, it will be a zero trade supply. So natural corollary of it. Section 11 of the IGST Act, which deals with place of supply in case of export of goods. There it says, in case of export of goods, the place of supply shall be the location outside India. Actually, location outside India means where the goods are delivered outside India or taken to a place outside India. So, going by the theoretical explanation, if suppose I have a foreign client who places an order on me for, let's say, some mold digs or dies, and he says that you manufacture and supply to my own job worker who is based in India. Let's say an auto company has a manufacturer in India who produces or manufactures auto parts for that company. They want tools, digs and molds time and again. So I am a mold, dig and tools manufacturer. I manufacture and give it to the auto the manufacturer of parts in India. The auto company is my customer. The Indian manufacturer of parts is not my customer. The customer is the auto company located outside India. In this case, whether it will be the supply made by me to the auto company located outside India, whether it will be an exports. If you go by the theoretical definition of exports, no, it will not fall under exports because the goods are not going to any place outside India. It was delivered to the auto company's job worker or manufacturer of parts in India. And therefore, there is not an export in the traditional sense, in the theoretical sense. However, there's a huge implications because of this. Once it is not considered an export, it will be loaded with taxes. When the policy of the government is, all across the world, in fact, all governments say the same thing, that taxes should not be exported. Only goods or services should be exported. However, in this case, though I am earning in foreign currency, I am not going to export. This transaction will not be termed as an export of goods. And it will still be liable for GST. Therefore, my price either has to be built in or I have to take additional from the auto company. In both conditions, what is exported is not just the goods, but along with it, the taxes are also exported. And this situation, I think it's a policy matter, definitely. It's a larger issue. But this issue can be sorted out by the government by deeming this kind of transactions to be a deemed export. Just like we have deemed exports for supplies made to advanced authorization or supplies made to EPCG license holder. All these kind of transactions are deemed, four transactions are deemed to be exports. Even though these supplies are made to parties in India, the goods are not leaving a place outside India, but still they are deemed to be exports. So this transaction can also be considered over there. There's one typical example which I want to talk about. What will be the situation if the Indian exporter is supplying to foreign party, but delivers the goods to an SEZ unit as per the instruction of the foreign customer?
Export.
So, somebody said export. There are diverse views. I've taken this typical example, which we had in our internal discussion also. In my view, this is a little dicey situation where this kind of transaction, though the supply is made to the foreign buyer, the goods are delivered to SEZ unit, it does not fall under the exports criteria because the goods are not leaving from India to any place outside India. The first definition of export, it does not qualify over there. Secondly, somebody might say then, but still you have delivered it to SEZ unit and therefore it will be a zero rated supply. No. If you see section 16 properly, it says supply of goods or services to a special economic zone developer or a special economic zone unit. It does not say delivery to an SEZ developer or delivery to an SEZ unit. It says supplies to an SEZ developer or SEZ unit. I am only delivering to SEZ unit. I am not supplying to SEZ unit. So therefore, it will not fall under zero rated supply also. In this kind of transactions, there will be again the same treatment. It will be treated as either IGST supply or interstate supply liable to CGSAS depending upon the where the goods are delivered. If it's in the same state, it will be interstate supply. So this is how I've taken up the issues on the issues related to exports. Now, there is another question which arose in our discussion was whether this supplies to SZ will be default interstate supplies and liable to IGST under Section 75 because no place of supply can be determined for this. In my view, it will be a straitjacket formula of Section 10 which will be applicable for this kind of transactions rather than going to Section 75 because Section 75 is when place of supply cannot be determined. In this case, it can be determined by applying the Section 10 of the IGST Act, 101A or 101B, both. And therefore, it will be accordingly to be treated as a supply, interstate or interstate supply. So, this is two major issues which I had in my mind regarding the exports criteria. There are many other issues, small issues, but I thought we'll more focus on refund issues. Okay, because that is a burning topic. So let us now go to the procedural issues in refund. Okay. So first issue which I want to take up, these are procedural only, but I'll still take up refunds held up for mismatch in GST invoice and shipping bill. This is one of the common and most common issues. At least for the better half of 2018, we had these issues coming up day in and day out for our clients. Where there was a mismatch in the GST invoice and the mismatch in the shipping bill. And therefore, refunds were held up. The Master Circular 125 of 2019 stated that, and prior to that, circulars are also there. All circulars merged up into this Master Circular of 125 of 2019. It stated that lowest of the value has to be taken. Why this difference used to arise is because when you prepare the GST invoice, you prepare, let's say, in day one. When the exchange rate is, let's say, 75 rupees a dollar. Whereas when the shipping bill is filed, the customs rate is different. It says 76. And therefore, there is a change in the value in shipping bill and the GST invoice. The other kind of mismatch in the GST invoice and shipping bill can be, again, in the case of GST wrongly mentioned in the shipping bill or shipping bill number wrongly mentioned in the GSTR1. So, all these types of mismatch used to happen. The Master Circular has given ways to it. As far as value is concerned, the instruction to the field formation, that is the revenue authorities, is that lowest of the value is to be taken. As far as mismatch in the GST invoice and GSTR1 is concerned, if the mistake is in GSTR1, it can be corrected. No problem. You can correct it in the next GSTR1 for the same invoice number. But if the mistake is in, let's say, shipping bill, now this is very important. Because the shipping bill cannot be amended once it is filed in the EDI system of the customs. So, the custom system is built in such a way that once the shipping bill is filed, no amendment whatsoever will be allowed. So, therefore, it cannot be amended. There is no way out. A lot of representations have been made to the GST authorities as well as the customs department regarding this. One of the ways out is that you can file a manual application with the customs authorities for amending the shipping bill, which they give manually. It will not be again amended on the system, in the EDI system. So therefore, there will not be a direct matching. But as far as documentary proof is concerned, you can ask for an amendment in the shipping bill, which can be given. And this amended shipping bill, then you can take it up with the authorities that on this basis, the refund has to be released. So this is the only way out which I have in currently found in this particular issue. So this is, I think we are done with this issue. Now let's go to the other issue which we are facing. Refunds held for non-matching of export ledger. Now many of us must be doing compliance work and filing refund applications, and then we must have found that despite let's say there is an export in the month of January 2020 and we have filed correct GSTR1 and in 3B also we have filed it. The transaction has been filed. But despite this filling up the transactions, the refund applications cannot be submitted or the refund application, though submitted, is not sanctioned. The main reason is because export ledger is not matching. On the portal, there is something called as export ledger. So whenever you are showing certain exports of, let's say, 1,000 rupees plus 18% GST on that, 180 rupees, then in that case, the GSTR1 will debit 180 rupees to the export ledger. And when you file the 3B, you have to show this very same amount of 180 rupees in the export column of the 3B. Then that much amount, 180 rupees, is credited in the export ledger. So there will be a matching of it. Balance will be zero. If this balance is zero or negative, then the refund is not released. It's an automatic control check which the portal has put in place. So therefore, it cannot be issued unless you amend the 3B. Now, this is a universal challenge whether 3B can be amended or not. There was one circular in December 2017, which provided various ways to amend GSTR 3B. In this circular, if we see, there is no somebody has unmute the there is kindly mute because there's a lot of different.
Sir, I check this.
No problem. You don't make me because I'll have to then otherwise unmute.
Okay.
So this circular provided various ways in which we can amend the transaction. It does not allow the amendment of 3B. For example, you have reported less exports in the month of January 2020. This circular says that you reported in the month of February 2020. Increase that much figure in the month of February 2020 GSTR 3B, and that is what the solution is. Now, this solution is, as far as GST is concerned, workable solution, no doubt about it. But the best solution would have been the amendment of 3B itself. And there is no hamper in the law. There is no, it is for the operational reasons which the government is not allowing the amendment of 3B. But as far as law is concerned, there is no bar in allowing the amendment of 3B. 17-18, which was the first year of implementation of GST, July 17 onwards, many people have made mistakes while filing the GSTR 3B. Instead of reporting it in the export column, they have reported in the exempted supplies column. And because of this, the export ledger is not telling and their refunds are held up. Even today, these people are finding answers to it. And when they go by the circular of December 2017, they have to include that turnover in the current 3B after 2 years, let's say. This will result in additional problems of reconciliation after 2-3 years when I go and file the GST audit. So all this is actually making the task of reconciliation more and more complicated and not a simplified return, basically. Simplified return system, if I may say. Recently, Delhi High Court, in the case of Bharti Airtel Limited, this was not an export case, let me tell you, but it was a case where Bharti Airtel initially, from July to September 2019, they were not able to reconcile in their systems how much ITC they have. And therefore, they were taking less ITC on some estimated basis. They filed their returns, paid excess tax in cash to the extent of 923 crores. Thereafter, recently in 2019, when they filed their GST audits, they got to know that this much ITC has remained. They sought to amend their 3B. The department rejected it. They filed a writ petition. In the writ petition, they took the specific stand that this circular, when it says that the effect of this amendment has to be in the month in which the discrepancy is noticed, they said that this has to go down. It has to be allowed in the month in which the transaction relates. For example, I had the ITC of July 17, which I get to know in, let's say, December 2019. I should be allowed to amend the 3B of July 17 and not the 3B of December 17. Now, this particular judgment is a favorable judgment, which says that they read down the para 4 of the circular dated 29/12/2017 and held that amendment GSTR 3B should be allowed in the same month to which the error relates. Secondly, it also holds that the SSC cannot be made to suffer because of the fault of government in implementing the GST. When initially they brought in GST, they were going to bring both GSTR 1, GSTR 2 and the final return GSTR 3. GSTR 2 and 3 never came into picture. And this was done away with for good. In fact, they are coming up with a new return system now. So therefore, the High Court said that in this particular fact, Bharti Airtel cannot be made to suffer because of the fault of the government in implementing the system. And since they had no opportunity to verify this ITC from GSTAT 2 and 3, 2A also came in the later part of 2018. So therefore, they say that nothing doing. They should be allowed to rectify the 3B of the month in which that error has occurred. So this is a favorable judgment. I don't know how far other high courts are going to complement or contradict this particular decision. But as on date, Delhi High Court has given a really good judgment, which indirectly says that you should be allowed to revise the 3B in the month in which the transaction is related. And if this is done, then a lot of problems will be solved, even for the ITC, which remained to be taken before the September period. So the September deadline or the GST audit deadline. So this is a real good judgment. One should go through it. The next issue which comes up is refunds held for manual filing of shipping bill where data is not uploaded on IceGate portal. So this is again a typical issue. I have more than 2-3 cases on this very aspect. What happens is typically this is a case in diamond exporters or jewelry exporters. So let's say in BKC we have Diamond Bureau. It has a separate customs station over there. From there, the goods are cleared by filing shipping bill and then transported out of India. Earlier, in the initial stages of say July 17 onwards, this particular customs station was allowing manual filing of shipping bill. One may come to various things. I mean, that's how a lot of frauds have taken place by allowing manual filing of shipping bill. But however, this was allowed at that time. And during this period, manual shipping bill is filed, the data is not uploaded in the EDI system or the IceGate portal. Therefore, there is no matching of the GSTR1 and the IceGate portal and the refunds are stuck. Till date, I have not found any solution to this. We wrote quite a bit of letters also to the department authorities. We also had a talk with the GST. There's a special wing for customs wing, refund related wing in the North Block. In Delhi somewhere. We spoke to those guys also. They say that they'll come out with some solution to this. But till date, there's no solution to it. So this is one issue. I don't know how many have seen this. Because in 2013, from 2013 onwards, EDI system was made compulsory. But still, in certain places in India, manual shipping bills were allowed to be filed. And therefore, this is one issue which needs to be catered to or looked into by the government. I don't have any typical or any solution to this. Let's go to the next issue. The next issue is refund held up for verification in case of suspected dealers. Now, this is the recent the government has recently in December 2019 onwards, they say that we'll take out a list of suspected dealers and these dealers will be 100% verification, physical verification before these goods are exported and their refunds will also not be granted till there is a proper inspection of their documents and everything. It's basically GST departmental audit of the entire transactions. So there's a circular which was issued in January 2020. Where they say that the applicant whose refunds and the exports have been stuck, they are so-called, suspected dealers, suspicious dealers. So in those cases, they will have to file Annexure A to the jurisdictional officer and the customs authorities. The verification of the entire documents will have to be completed within 15 days and refund has to be granted. If nothing is done within 30 days, then they can take up the grievance cell. The issue is not about the verification. A genuine dealer definitely will have all the documents to show. The issue is when it comes to verification, the assessing or the jurisdiction authorities are not merely taking a transaction for that particular exports or for that particular period for which refund has been filed. What they are doing is they are trying to assess the dealers right from 2017, going through all the documents. Naturally, it is going to take time. Cannot be confirmed in 15 days. Secondly, even after doing all these assessments, there is no order passed. I have not seen any order passed till date. They will only allow the exports to be made. After that, due to this lockdown period, in 2-3 cases which I have not been able to follow up. The client has also not been able to follow up. But after this lockdown, I have not seen any orders during or after this lockdown being passed, allowing the refund and completing this audits right from the July 2017. So therefore, this is a major issue because the transactions, though it is audited, no order is passed. They will merely allow the refund if at all, and there will be no documentation of this audit, a formal order which says that everything is perfect, good and valid. So therefore, that is something which the department should look at, and they should bring in a procedure for passing the orders itself so that the assessment is also complete so far as this assesses are concerned. Now, going to the next issue, refund held up for wrong bank account details. So this is a very simple issue. Many times refunds are held up only because the bank accounts are not properly mentioned in the, or there's a change in the bank account and the common portal is not updated. So this can be done by simply filing an amendment, and it's an encore field and can be easily amended. Now, refunds held for claim of drawback. Now, this is another issue. Initially, when GST came in July 17, prior to that, the manufacturers were eligible to claim drawback on inputs which are used for exporting the final product. These drawback rates were at a higher rate, let's say 7.5% to 9% in that category. In the CGST law, section 54 puts an embargo that in case you have claimed drawback on the inputs of goods exported, then the CGST refund will not be available to you. The assessing officers or the refund officers, they have been utilizing this particular provision, extending it to the SGST also. That is one part of it, which I'll come to it. Secondly, I wanted to know what is the exact law. So I went through the entire circulars, I went to the provisions and found out that, yes, up to August 2017, there was only higher rate of drawback. So people who have claimed drawback on inputs, they were not eligible for CGST refund. But they were definitely eligible for SGST refund. There is no bar under the SGST Act, the state GST Act. So therefore, they were eligible for SGST refund. There will be no CGST refund. After August 2017, there were two rates of drawback prescribed. One is a lower rate, something around 1.5%, which is for capital goods and all. The other is the higher rate. Now, if you claim drawback at higher rate, only then your CGST refunds can be held up or it can be denied. As far as lower rate is concerned, where you have claimed the drawback at lower rate, the CGST refund cannot be denied. It has to be granted. And this is by their own circular. The circular I have also noted in the second bullet point. Circular number 37 of 2018. Customs dated 9th October 2018. So therefore, when the drawback is claimed for CGST at the higher rate, then only this denial will sustain. Otherwise, it will not. And what will be the question? When, because in exports, we claim refund of IGST. Then this IGST has to be broken down into two. SGST has to be granted in full and CGST has to be granted depending upon the drawback rate which you have claimed. So this is so the conclusion is that even if you have claimed drawback, whether higher rate, lower rate, there can be no denial of SGST refund. CGST refund can be denied only if the higher rate drawback is claimed. Coming to the next issue, refund to merchant exporters. Now, this scheme of merchant exporter, we are very well aware that following this scheme is itself not many merchant exporters would want to go because there is complete disclosure of the buyers, foreign buyers, then your suppliers and all those things. So, therefore, merchant exporters are more reluctant to go into this scheme because the suppliers come to know of the foreign buyers. Unless and until you have strong ties with the foreign buyers, then only a merchant exporter will go into this scheme. However, even if we go by that, a merchant exporter is not merely purchasing inputs from the local manufacturer in India and exporting out of India, but is also having other purchases, let's say input services, let's say rent of an office and all those things. So whether those inputs which he is getting, even when the 0.1% which is being charged by the local manufacturer, whether those inputs will be available as refund, this is the question. And for this, there is specifically subrule 4A to rule 18 which is inserted, which says that ITC to merchant exporters will be available as refund in full. So where you have an export turnover, you are a merchant exporter, your vendor has charged you only 0.1%, that 0.1% is also eligible as refund. Plus you have other inputs and input services that also will be available as refund. You just have to file a refund application of under the category of accumulated unutilized ITC on account of exports. So that will be available. This one issue I thought I'll include because many people have still some doubts on this issue. The other issue which I'm taking up is whether export of goods requires proof of inward remittance. As far as export of service is concerned, the law, the export of service itself specifies that the consideration should be in foreign currency. The rule also specifically says that in case of export of services, you have to submit the FIRC, that is the foreign inward remittance certificate, which shows that the foreign currency has been realized in India. Only then the refund is granted. But as far as goods is concerned, there was no such condition under the law. There is no proof required for foreign inward remittance in case of export of goods. This was specifically included in para 36, if I'm right, para 36 of this master circular, which specifically says that in case of the supply of goods, proof of foreign inward remittance is not envisaged in the law. Therefore, the law itself was silent on this. This was not required. However, recently, by notification dated 16 of 2020, third amendment to the rules in 2020, dated 23rd March 2020, a new rule 96B has been inserted. As per this rule, if the sale proceeds are not realized fully or partially within the time period allowed under FEMA, then proportionate refund granted shall be liable to be paid back along with interest within 30 days from the expiry of time limit of realization. In other words, after the insertion of this rule 96B, I'm still not liable to produce the certificate of foreign inward remittance at the time of filing refund application. I may be granted refund pending the recovery from the foreign buyer. However, there's a time limit prescribed under FEMA for realizing the foreign currency in case of exports. Let's say that's 6 months. So from within 6 months of export, if I don't realize this particular foreign currency and I have already been granted refund, then from 30 days from the end of this 6 month, I have to refund or rather pay back the refund amount to the government along with interest. This is how the rule has been worded. I will also be entitled to get back this refund when I realize this particular foreign currency, provided under FEMA this delay has been condoned. So the rule has been made in a complicated way. Firstly, and my view, this is a measure to counter the fake exports and fake refund claims. However, this will bring a lot of hardship to the genuine exporters, which is the majority of the, or rather 90% of the industry. They'll have to keep on proving for a genuine reason. Suppose, even though the goods are exported, sometimes the matters are under dispute and because of which the foreign currency does not come, or due to some or the other reasons, let's say there's a defect, the foreign buyer does not pay in full. He pays only 60%, 40%, 80%, whatever it is. Then in that case, for the balance unpaid amount, the refund has to be paid back to the government along with interest. So I think this is against the entire scheme of the refunds. It is a one step further. Even though these are meant for as countermeasures for fake fraud and fraudulent ITC and refund claims, but still this will be a hardship to the genuine exporters. On one hand, they'll be already they must have already lost the money at the hands of the foreign buyer. Plus, this government taking up the refund will also be another huge blow to the industry. So, therefore, I think this particular rule may be challenged in the coming days, but the effect has to be seen, because after the introduction of this rule, not many applications have been processed because of this lockdown. So, let's see and wait how this rule takes its future course. Next issue is transfer of amount within cash ledger, whether possible. So, I'll give you my own case, my own example, in the sense one of my client's case. What happened is, and day in and day out, we must be coming across this kind of things. My client is a CA who was filing returns for his client. So, while filing the returns, there was a liability arising in SGST of 5 lakh rupees. So, the client asked him to make the payment. The CA asked the client to make the payment. But instead of making the payment in the SGST column of the cash ledger, the client wrongly paid it under cess column. And there is no liability at all for cess for this particular client. So, therefore, there was no other way out but for filing return, pay another 5 lakh rupees in SGST and file the return and claim the refund of cess. This was an issue which was pointed out in a number of cases, and in the initial period, many people had made mistakes in this. But only in June 19, the government realized this, and they brought in a new provision, Rule 87, Subrule 13, wherein they said that you can, by filing PMT 09, transfer from one cash ledger to another cash ledger, let's say from cess account to SGST account, from interest account in SGST to interest account in CGST, and so on and so forth, but only between the cash ledger. So therefore, this PMT 09 was brought in June 19 itself. However, it has been made effective only in April 2020 by this notification number 37 of 2020. So till April 2020, the people's money who had been wrongly paid in this wrong account, let's say cess or excess paid in SGST, and not being able to utilize because of the excess ITC in CGST, IGST and all. So therefore, this was lying idle, blockage of working capital. And there was no other way out but to file a refund application. So now this PMT 09 has been made effective, and therefore they can file a PMT 09 for transferring this cash ledger, cash balance in one ledger to another ledger. The other problem in this is people who have already filed refund application, for example, in my client's case, they will not be able to file this PMT 09 because while filing the refund application, their amount has already been debited and it is blocked. So there is nothing in cess account today for transferring it to the SGST account. So unless until the refund officers allow and credit it back into the cess account, then only it will be allowed to be transferred by PMT 09 to the SGST account. So this also they should have taken consideration of, but however they have not considered it. So they, however, at least something is possible now by filing PMT 09. Coming to the next issue, now let's go to the legal issues in refund. First issue which I want to take up is whether refund can be filed under an inverted rated supply if refund is already filed for zero rated supply. So many times it happens. My inputs are at 18%. I convert it into a final finished product. The finished product is liable at 5%. For example, if I give you a ready example, then in the belt industry, the inputs for the belt are available at 18% belt, the apparel which I'm talking about. And when it is exported in non-branded condition, it is at 5%. And therefore, firstly, when you file refund application for export, that will be available on the accumulated ITC, but that is in the proportionate ratio of the export turnover. Apart from that, still there will be unaccumulated ITC, unutilized ITC. That is because of the rate difference of the input and the output. That is inverted rated structure. In those cases, in my view, you can still file another refund application for the same period under the other category. And this has been clarified by the CBIC also in the master circular. Therefore, a separate refund application has to be filed, one for the exports and another for the one for the zero rated supply and another for the inverted rated structure. So this way, this can be solved by that way. Refund of excess tax charged. Now, this I am coming to from the point of view of tax which is wrongly paid, whether by utilizing cash or whether by utilizing ITC. Some of the examples can be, let's say the supplier charges at 18% on supply to end consumer, even though the consumer is liable at 12%. There may be some reverse situations where the consumer is liable at 12%, but the supplier charges 18%. Or where the supply is cancelled. So let's say I entered into a supply contract, I raised the invoices, and while the supplies were being made, the September period is over, September after the financial year, immediately after the financial period is over, and I cancel the supply. Can I issue a credit note? That's the question. Because that has to be reversed, that tax has to be entirely reversed because the supply contract is cancelled. And where suppose the credit notes are issued after a long time due to, let's say, the supplier and the recipient were in the litigation. So there was a price adjustment, and according to which the credit note or debit note has to be issued. If it's a debit note, no problem, you can always make the payments. But when it comes to credit note, the GST law under section 34.1 and 34.2 restricts the issue of credit notes to the month, the due date for return of September for immediately following the financial in which the period relates, invoice relates. So therefore, there is a lot of restrictions brought under GST where you cannot easily reverse the transaction if it is beyond the time limit of the September return. In my view, all these kind of supplies where it has been cancelled or excess tax has been paid, the government is bound to give the refund. They cannot retain these refunds, and there should not be any time limit also for this. We'll come to the time limit, which is the last I'm taking up, but there should not be, without any time limit, these refunds have to be granted. And it can be filed under the category of excess tax charged. This has to be filed if I am sure that at the first level or the second level, this refunds may be rejected. But without fighting, this refunds will not be available. And this will be a complete loss to the assessees. So this kind of transactions are more common in construction industries where agreements are cancelled, or in case of service industries. And in fact, recently, because of this COVID-19 also, many suppliers and recipients may invoke the force majeure clause and cancel the contracts or not be able to satisfy the contracts. Therefore, services are cancelled. In this case, the government, CBIC, has also issued one circular in the month of April 2020, wherein they have stated that firstly, you try to adjust it. If it is not adjusted against the against your liability shown, then you can claim refund. So that is how the CBIC is also of the view. And therefore, this has to be practically implemented now. That's the only thing. Next issue, accumulation of ITC on imported goods due to overvaluation in the customs, whether it can be claimed as refund. Now, this is a typical issue, and we mostly find it in the scrap industry. Suppose I'm a scrap dealer, I'm importing scrap, let's say from China. Now, the customs department has a particular notion that if suppose I import the scrap at $100 per ton, the department says that this is undervalued. Customs department says that this is undervalued. You have the minimum value of this scrap should be $200 per ton. So what they do is they assess the bill of entry at $200 per ton, even though I have paid only $100 per ton to the supplier from China. In those cases, the IGST will be also charged on this customs value of $200 per ton. Therefore, I am paying much higher IGST than, it's actually double the IGST in my example, which I should have been liable to pay. I pay this IGST while clearing and filing the bill of entry, and I take the credit of it. However, this industry of scrap works on very thin margin, not more than 2-3%. So when they further sell these products in the Indian industry, Indian market, they will not be able to utilize this double IGST which they have paid, the higher rate of IGST which they have paid. The entire credit is lying unutilized, accumulated in their account. Even if they try as hard as they can, they will not be able to utilize this particular ITC, which is nothing but lost money, if we can say. Because they are not able to utilize the ITC anywhere unless they have any other business where they have higher margins. But when they have other business, they have ITC of that business also. Still, they will not be able to utilize this ITC. And this is an issue which I have represented to the government, but there is no answer to it. And this is some issue. Many in the industry must be facing this similar kind of issues, because there the customs is valuing the transaction at a very high rate, and therefore they are not able to sell it. So in my example, let's say $100 I pay to the Chinese exporter, and I sell it in the to Indian customer at $102. I don't make more than $2 as margin. That's 2%. But the IGST is paid on $200. So this is going to be accumulated ITC, and unless the government looks into this, this is a lost money for the dealers. Coming to the next example, refund of payments made under DRC-03 under mistake of law. So it's a very common thing. What we call is payment under during investigation or payment under protest. So sometimes during investigation, during survey, the department forces to make the payment under DRC-03, showing so-and-so irregularities in our accounts and all. We pay at that time just to buy peace at that time. But these are payments under protest. And more common in refund application, if you see, for the ITC, which is not appearing your GSTR 2A, the officers are first asking you to make that payment in DRC-03, and only then the refund should be granted. That is what their stand is. Otherwise, they don't pass the refund, final refund orders. So this point, I think, and for the other example can be ocean freight. Many people filed the returns and paid the taxes on ocean freight. After this Mohit Mandal case in Gujarat High Court, the ocean freight is not liable for RCM, let us say. So in those cases, DRC-03 was filed at the time of investigation. They paid the taxes. They could not take the credit also many times because GST audit must have been completed. And after that, this Gujarat High Court case must have come. So in that case, what will happen? Whether we are eligible to take any refund of this taxes paid through DRC-03? In my view, this will be governed by the excess tax paid clause under Section 54(8). And therefore, this tax, even though paid voluntarily under DRC-03, can be claimed as refund and should be claimed as refund, because this is not a tax. And once it is a pre-deposit which we are making under protest, there are a number of judgments to say that whatever payment is made under investigation is nothing but under protest. And however, a simple letter at the time of making payment also makes your case very strong and foolproof that this is payment made under protest. In any case, DRC-03 heading says voluntary payment, but you can always claim that it is under protest, and therefore refund can be claimed as excess tax paid. This is one issue which I wanted to bring to your notice. The other issue is value of export turnover for ITC refund is amended. Now, this is also the recent amendment which I'm talking about, of the March 2020 third amendment, notified 16 of 2020. There is a under Rule 89(4). There is a formula for arriving at the refund amount, which is the numerator is the value of exports, that is zero rated supplies. The denominator is the value of zero rated supplies plus the other local supplies, that is the aggregate turnover total for the tax period, into the net ITC. Now, in this rule, the C which was defined as the zero rated supply, the turnover of zero rated supply. This has been amended, and this amendment now reads like this. This clause C defines the turnover of zero-rated supply like this. Turnover of zero-rated supply of goods means the value of zero-rated supply of goods made during the relevant period without payment of tax under bond or letter of undertaking, or the value which is 1.5 times the value of the like goods domestically supplied by the same or similarly placed supplier as declared by the supplier, whichever is less, other than the turnover of supplies in respect of which refund is claimed under Rule 4A or 4B or both. simple terms, let's say I'm exporting under bond at 100 rupees a particular product, a mobile phone. Now this mobile phone, I supply to a local party, local customer in India at 150 rupees. So as per this particular new definition of turnover related supplies, I will compare this 100 and 150, and whichever is lower, I will take. Therefore, 100 rupees is my value of zero-day supply for this particular formula only, not under the law, not under in your accounting system or GST system, not in the invoice, but for this particular formula only. Now, if I say I export this mobile at 150 rupees, and to the local customer, I export, I sell it at 80 rupees. In those case, my value of turnover of zero date supply will be restricted to 80 rupees or 1.5 to 80, whichever that amount comes, whichever is lower. So 1.5 to 80 will be my 120 rupees. 120 rupees will be my turnover of supply of zero date goods. Sorry, zero date supply of goods. Though I have realized exports consideration of 150 rupees, my turnover by this artificial definition, it is restricted to 120 rupees. The two questions. One, whether this particular, if suppose I'm supposed to implement this law in my regular books and accounts, whether this will be applicable at the time of filing refund application or it will be a part of assessment of refund applications. According to me, at the time of filing a refund application, you have to consider 150 only, because there is no way in which you can compare your local supply with your export supplies and then yourself determine that this is undervalued or overvalued. This cannot be done. Therefore, while filing a refund application, it will be 150 rupees only. Now, the second question comes, whether the refund officer can go into my books of accounts and determine that this 120 rupees or 80 rupees at which I have exported, or 150 rupees of which I have exported, is overvalued, and therefore he can apply and say that I will see the value of the goods which you have supplied domestically, the same form which you have supplied to any other customer in India, and I'll accordingly determine the export value. There is no guidelines provided for this. The second thing they say, that the value of goods of like goods domestically supplied by the same or similarly placed supplier. So if I don't have supply of these goods to any other customer in India, they will go to my competitors or they will go to other distributors and find out that the same phone has been sold to his customers at what rate, and then they will compare it. So according to me, this is a draconian rule. This is nothing. This is a countermeasure for stopping the fraudulent ITC and refund claims. However, this will be affecting the regular exporters, which is 90% of the case. And the assessing officers will now have a handle in their hand to arm twist the assessees. They may go to any extent. They will go to my competitors and find out they have sold it at a loss. And in that case, they will apply that value. So this is going to be a huge implication. I don't know whether the government has taken into consideration all these things before amending this rule. The second thing I want to point out in this rule is, this is against the very fabric of GST, which is a transaction-based levy. So when Section 15 of the CGST Act says the transaction value shall be any consideration in money or in kind between two unrelated parties, and where price is the sole consideration, then there is no question of going behind the transaction and finding an artificial value to transaction value. This is a total defiant law, and this is what I was talking about when I was talking about excessive delegation. This cannot be allowed, because then you are, Section 15 will become meaningless. That is, the transaction value has to be determined in Section 15 only, and there are various rules under Section 15 to determine the value. In spite of those rules, amending this particular only for the refund purpose, I think it will be not feasible in law and should be challenged. So this is value of export turnover. So now let's go to the next issue. Value of export turnover for ITC refund is amended. Now, this is again curbing the amendment brought for curbing the bogus exports and exports at higher values. I have gone through this, right? Okay. Refund of tax paid on capital goods to exporters. This is again major issue, okay? Because many times your capital goods you have imported specifically for manufacturing goods and exported out of India, or even locally manufactured, and these capital goods have huge value. Huge ITC is accumulated on account of this capital goods. Section 54(3) says that you'll be entitled to ITC. Refund of unutilized input tax credit shall be allowed on the zero-rated supplies made without payment of tax, right? So therefore, when you talk about input tax credit, it is defined under the Act to include ITC on all three items: inputs, input services, and capital goods. But when it comes to the rule 89(4), in that very same formula which we were talking about in the earlier exam, in the earlier issue, the net ITC is defined to include ITC only on input and input services. Now, in my view, restricting the ITC on capital goods will ultimately lead to accumulation of ITC on capital goods forever, thereby blockage of working capital and making the exports uncompetitive. The other way to look at it is, this is against the very fabric of value-added system where all ITC should be granted, which is on the inputs and capital goods used for manufacturing the or supplying the outward supply. So therefore, this is from that point of view also not logical. Secondly, it is discriminatory, because when I export on payment of IGST, I can utilize the credit, which includes all ITC. Even on ITC and inputs, capital goods, and input services. But when it comes to the other way of claiming refund, that is against the unutilized ITC, where exports are made against bond or LUT, then they are saying that you will not get any refund on ITC on capital goods. Now, this is illogical, because when I make the payments and claim the refund, I can take entire ITC, even on capital goods. But when I claim the refund of ITC, I'm not supposed to get it. So this is one issue which I think the government should look into. And this is especially in this current scenario when they're saying that they want to make local manufacturing, promote local manufacturing more and more. This small issues will help the industrialists to set up new manufacturing units. The other issue is whether ITs on capital goods and input services are eligible for refund under inverted duty structure. Now, this is again, the law in this itself is very specific. When we see section 54(3), clause 2 to the proviso, there itself it is said that where the credit is accumulated on account of rate of tax on inputs being higher than the rate of tax on output supplies, which is rate of tax on inputs, not on input services or capital goods, being higher than the rate of tax on output supplies. Output supplies may be supply of goods, supply of services, or supply of both. Then in that case, the refund of unutilized ITC shall be available. So in my view, there are various views going around, but when the law itself is specific, the Act itself is specific, this is not in delegated legislation. This is not a restriction put by rules. In the law itself, it says that you'll be eligible to claim refund only in case of rate of tax on inputs being higher than the output supplies. Then it has to be restricted to that only. It cannot be extended to the input services and capital goods. It is a policy decision, and definitely representations are being made by various associations that even input services should be included in this. That is the government to decide. The second offshoot of this very issue is that whether all inputs will be considered for net ITC or only those inputs using inverted rated supply. Now, this I have personally come across this kind of problems in my client's case, that the refund officers, while assessing the refund applications, they are including only inputs directly going into those inverted rated supplies and not all the inputs in my return for that tax period. So, suppose I have two kinds of ingredients, two kinds of products also. Product A has ingredient X and product B has ingredient Y. Product A is taxable at 5% and X is taxable. Ingredient X is taxable at 18%. And B and Y are taxable at 18%. So, inverted rated supply is only for A. The refund officers are going and assessing the refund applications only on the basis that ITC of X only has to be considered, not of Y. But that is clarified in the master circular also and various other circulars previously also, that no, you have to take ITC of the entire tax period. The net ITC has to be for the entire tax period and not just of one ingredient or one particular input. It has to be for the entire tax period, and that has to be considered while calculating this refund under inverted rated structure. So this has also been clarified under the Master Circular 125. Coming to the next major issue, refund restriction to matching of ITC and GST are two-way. Now, we all know about this Rule 36-4, which restricts the ITC to the matched ITC plus 10% of the matched ITC. You cannot take more than that. As it is, that has created the complications with respect to reconciliations and all, because a genuine dealer wants to take all the ITC, all the genuine ITC. But as far as refund is concerned, we were allowed to claim the refund on the entire ITC, even if it was not falling under the GST 2A, it was not showing under GST 2A. The only thing which had to be done was matched ITC, there was no requirement. You can directly upload the GST 2A along with the refund application. That was enough. As far as unmatched ITC is concerned, you had to upload the invoices of the vendors self-attested. So that master circular had specified that earlier, it was specifically clarified that refund can be claimed for ITC not matching in GST 2A by uploading the invoice. Thereafter, it seems the revenue authorities have time and again represented to the CBIC that this is not possible in view of 36-4, and therefore the circular, the latest circular 135, they have amended that para, and now they say that since rule 36-4 has come into place, for all periods falling after rule 36-4, the refund applications have to be filed only for matched ITC. They cannot give you any ITC, any refund of ITC not matching with your 2A. Now, the circulars are silent. What will happen for the unmatched ITC? Whether I can claim refund in subsequent refund periods? What will happen if suppose subsequently I don't have to file any refund application at all because my exports are not there? What will happen when suppose I'm in the closure of my business, and though this ITC is now appearing my 2A, I'm not able to take the refund? So all these things are not considered by the circular. They have restricted the ITC to the matched ITC in 2A only for the refund purpose. Now, this is a rule which, just like 36-4, has to be challenged. This is nothing but recovery of the taxes from the buyers even before assessing the vendors. They may not have filed because of various reasons. We don't know. And this lockdown period, though this period has been extended to September now, but I'm sure we are going to see a lot of problems in this matching of 2A. And the reconciliation work is a tremendous task in this particular scenario. Therefore, I don't know how they are going to assess this and whether this restriction is proper. In my view, it is not proper. It should not be allowed. The law nowhere says, the sections nowhere say restrict to 2A. It is by rule, by sub-delegate legislation, where they are saying that you will not be entitled to refund. So this is something which has to be challenged. The other issue is whether the refund can be rejected on reduction of tax rate on output supply. This is another classical issue, typical issue, in fact. I already have one case on this for diamond suppliers, because initially diamond was taxable at 5%, then it was made to 3%. Similarly, now recently this resin cement was made from 28% to 18%. Let's say I am an
Rahul, I think you will have to unmute yourself.
Audio.
Yes, he's unmuted.
Yeah, you are unmuted, but you are not audible. Some problem with network.
Otherwise, battery charging also.
Rahul, are you there? Vinod, will you please call him?
Okay.
Audio.
Patkar sir, are you there?
No, we cannot listen anything.
Am I audible now?
Please?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think I automatically got logged out due to some network issue or something.
Yeah.
So I'll come back to my this. Okay. So I was on this. So I don't know till what issue I had, you were able to hear me. I'll take up the next issue now. Okay. अरे विनोद जी शेयर कंटेंट मेरे में से अलाउ कीजिए ना होस्ट बनाइए
हाँ वो बना देता वन सेक यू आर कोस्ट आल्सो अच्छा वन सेक दूसरा हिस्सा है
अलाउ नहीं हो पा
या ओके हो गया या यस यस राहुल गो है
यस वन
मिनट राहुल वी कैन सी योर प्रेजेंट स्क्रीन
या जस्ट वन मिनट नहीं वो मेरे में से नहीं था अभी दिख रहा है राइट सो नाउ आई एम कमिंग टू दिस इशू वेदर द रिफंड कैन बी रिजेक्टेड ऑन रिडक्शन ऑफ टैक्स रेट ऑन आउटपुट सप्लाई नाउ दिस इशू इज अ टिपिकल इशू बट इट विल अराइज इन मेनी केसेस वेयर द जीएसटी रेट्स आर रिड्यूस्ड आई वांट टू टेक वन एग्जांपल लेट्स से आई एम अ रीजन सीमेंट डिस्ट्रीब्यूटर आई हैव थाउजेंड्स ऑफ टन्स ऑफ सीमेंट लाइंग इन माई गोडाउन When I bought this cement, it was taxable at 28%. So my ITC is accumulated at 28%. Now, when I supply the cement further, it will be liable at 18%. So this margin of 10% will always be lying in my electronic credit ledger is unutilized, accumulated. Why I'm saying unutilized is because there are, as it is, very less margin. 10% margin in cement industry is huge for a retailer. Secondly, in any case, the new purchase will come with its own ITC. So therefore, to utilize this 10% will take a lot of time. In case of diamond, this is even worst case because diamonds are very high value items. And there was a change in rate of diamond from 5% to 3% in January 2018, due to which many people had accumulated ITC. They are not able to utilize that ITC even today. It will take years for them to utilize that ITC. This issue, now the circular of 135 of 2020, dated 31st March 2020, I don't know why they take up this issue, but in any case, they have taken up this issue and they say in that circular, CBIC says in that circular that the refund shall not be granted in case of reduction in GST rate because the input and the output remain the same. They are basically the same goods and therefore that refund will not be eligible. In my view, it's a wrong clarification given by the CBIC. If you see clause 2, it says where the credit has accumulated, it's extracting the in the slide itself, where the credit has accumulated on account of rate of tax on the inputs being higher than the rate of tax on the output supplies. It nowhere says that the inputs should be used in manufacturing or inputs need not be the same as output supplies. Nowhere in this clause 2 it is stated. Secondly, if we see the definition of inputs, it includes all goods going into the output supplies in simple terms. And if I may read out the specific definition, just 1 minute. So, input means any goods other than capital goods used or intended to be used by a supplier in the course or furtherance of business. Is the department saying, is the CBIC saying that this cement is not goods? If they're saying so, it will be incorrect. Are they saying that this cement has not, or this goods has not gone into my further course of business? That will be incorrect. Therefore, on what basis they are saying that refund will not be eligible to me and this will not fall under inverted rate structure? The only reasoning they say is your input and output is same goods, but that is not the criteria for inverted rate structure. The criteria is that the inputs have suffered the tax at higher rate than the output liability. And therefore, there is an accumulation. The precise reason for inverted rate structure, refund on inverted rate structure. So this particular thing will have to be challenged. It cannot be otherwise allowed to be in a circular allowed to be sustained. Coming to the last issue, whether refund can be claimed after the completion of 2 years from the relevant date. Now, this is a very larger issue where I'll definitely require the help of Chairman Sir. Relevant date is defined in Explanation 2 to Section 54. And as I told you that refunds and exports under GSTR are incorporated or same as it was in the excise law. There again, there was relevant date to Section 11B, defined the explanation to Section 11B. So over here also, we have relevant date. And the relevant date, before I go to that, Section 54.1 says that refund application has to be filed within 2 years from the relevant date. So therefore, this importance of relevant date while determining so and so. There are a number of judgments under the excise law while interpreting Section 11B, famous being the Mafatlal case, 9th judge bench of the Supreme Court, stating that this time limit of 1 year prescribed in 11B is not procedural, it's mandatory, and therefore no refund can be allowed after 1 year, even if application is filed. Now, how far these judgments are going to play a role in the context of GST, I don't know. That has to be challenged and seen in the court of law. But going by the basic fabric of refund and value added scheme of GST, this particular provision of 2 years from relevant date has to be read as procedural. Otherwise, this entire VAT system will fail. Why I'm saying it will fail is because if the ITC refund is not granted, then the very very intent of reducing the cascading effect will go away. And especially GST being a new law, when in first 2-3 years, definitely people are bound to make many mistakes. They are bound to make forget about applications. They are bound to when the government itself can make many mistakes implementing GST, I think sure the assessors are not God, and therefore they are also eligible to make mistakes. So therefore, this 2 years thing should not be read as mandatory. It should be read as procedural in nature. The second point I want to raise over here is there was an amendment by CGST Amendment Act of 2018, which came into effect from 1st February 2019. By this amendment, clause A in explanation 2 to section of this relevant date was amended. Let us go to that amended section for a minute. If we go to that. So before the amendment, this is the clause E. In the case of refund, before the amendment, I'm reading the footnote 3. In the case of refund of unutilized input tax credit under subsection 3, the end of the financial year in which such claim for refund arises was the relevant date. So therefore, for the period 17-18, in the unamended clause E, the relevant date would be the end of the financial year, that is 31st March 2018. And 2 years from that would complete on 31st March 2020. Therefore, for all refund applications under 54(3), refund could be filed up to 31st March 2020. However, from 1st February 2019, this clause was amended, and in the new clause, it is stated that in case of refund of unutilized input tax credit under clause 2 of first proviso to subsection 3, the due date for furnishing of return under section 39 for the period in which such claim for refund arises. So this is amended, and now the clause is restricted to only inverted rate structure, when the relevant date is now prescribed to be the date of due date of furnishing return for the period for which the claim relates. The question now arises because we have seen, I have already got to see the orders where refunds are rejected for 17-18 period, relying on this amended clause E along with the clause A, and saying that since now the time limit is restricted to due date of the furnishing return, therefore this is time barred for 17-18. In my view, this amendment in clause E is not retrospective. It is prospective only. There is nowhere any suggestion in the CGST Amendment Act of 2018 or any other circular that this is retrospective. Therefore, for all tax periods prior to 1st February 2019, the refund should be granted by 31st if applications are made by 31st March 2020. The amendment in clause will be applicable only from 1st February 2019 and not prior to that. That is my opinion on this. Definitely, that has to be further taken up in the appeals if the refunds are rejected. So with this, I conclude. I think I have, somewhat in time. And therefore, with this, I'll hand over to the chairman, sir, to take up the further session.
May I request Rohit to stop sharing the screen?
Yes, yes. I have made it stop sharing.
Hello?
Yes, Patkar sir.
Hello, Patkar sir.
I am audible now?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
I quoted a barabar.
Yes, yes, sir, yes.
I am not much conversant to this thing, okay?
Carry on, sir, carry on.
Now, see, firstly, I should congratulate Rahul for taking so much labor. His paper is very good, lengthy, and he has really taken labor. He has taken so much labor that 50% paper he has sent yesterday at 5 o'clock, and 50%, not 50%, little less than that, today morning at 9 o'clock, and thereafter he has added some issues. So anyway, Rahul, I must congratulate you. Whatever you have written is excellent. Now, in my address, I will touch only those topics or issues which he has not covered
पाटकर साहेबांना अनम्यूट करा परत. पाटकर साहेब तुम्ही म्यूट झालेत बघा तुम्ही. बोला साहेब बोला.
सो देर सी व्हेअरएव्हर देर आर पॉसिबल सी व्हेअरएव्हर देर आर नो कॉन्ट्रोवर्सीज आय विल नॉट कमेंट ऑन दॅट. Wherever there is a possible view, I will not comment on that. I shall speak only where there is, in my opinion, what should be the correct position of law and the issues which he has not covered. Now, the very first issue which he has requested the chairman to address regarding the limitation. Now kindly understand, section 61 is for assessment. Section 61 does not give, it is quite different from our VAT law. I am the person who had argued vichare and vichare and that silver dot etc. and got refund for that 501, again that 501. However, here the position is different. Words are different, so section 61 has to be read with section 73 and section 74 of the CGST or SGST Act, whatever it is. You can't go after examining it, you will understand, you can't go out of section 54.1. You have to follow section 54.1 and the Supreme Court judgment in Mafatlal Industries, 1997, 1980-47, and Annam Electrical, 1997, 1980-60. Both squarely apply with full force, they apply. No scope for refund outside section 54. Now the law, according to me, the correct position of law is, the limitation of 2 years from the relevant date will apply. So far, wherever there is illegality. However, wherever there is a constitutional challenge, wherever there is unconstitutional provision, then 3 years limitation will apply. 3 years limitation, you will have to file writ petition and 3 years limitation will apply. That is the law laid down by the Mafatlal and Annam, by the Supreme Court. Now, so far as that proposition is concerned, where I think I might have misunderstood, where Rahul is saying that judgment in some other case, that is also settled by Mafatlal. So therefore, if judgment is coming in some other case, maybe by the Supreme Court, you don't get any benefit of limitation. Limitation still remains on here. Now, in that case, the Bombay High Court excluded the period of the which was there, for which they were there in the court. So, kindly understand, if you have some grievance about your refund, keep on litigating. If you sit tight, the Mafatlal will apply. Mafatlal and Annam both will apply with full force. Now, my friend Rahul has also spoken about relevant date. That amendment which has been made to the explanation to clause E, Section 54, where the law has been substituted, and now the earlier the limitation was running from the end of the financial year. Now it will run from the date of filing of returns from the end of the tax period. Now they have curtailed the period. Now, in this case, Hussain Qasim Daza will apply and it is a vested right. And that amendment is prospective, it has prospective operation. If that be, keep it in your mind, and if your refund application is rejected, file a writ immediately against that. So this is what my view. I will give you one more judgment. Kindly write it down. DK Educational versus Parag Gupta, 2019, in 11 SCC, page 633. They have concluded this issue, what you have raised. Okay. Now, I will go to other issues which you have not covered. Now, section 54.1, it speaks about, now see, so far as export is concerned, what has Rahul has spoken, I have 99% I have agreed to it. Only thing about this export which this one, all those theories which were developed under the Central Substance Act will now, they will not apply, because the definition says that goods taken out of India. Only thing, Burma Shell will still apply, where Burma Shell is saying that export means imported in some other country. So that will still apply. Otherwise, when they are saying it's goods taken out of India, so that definition will apply. And section 11, which speaks about place of supply for export of goods, it has no practical value. It is only for the apportionment of taxes between central and state government. And now again I will revert back to this one, 54.1, where it is saying any person. Now kindly understand, any person denotes that even a purchaser, not only a supplier, even a purchaser can file for refund. That is why there is a judgment now on this. The Delhi High Court in Shyam Kumar Bansal versus Union of India, 2016, 92 VST 330. In clear words, they said that even a purchaser can file for the refund. Now, only thing you have to be careful that if you file a writ petition, then you should join both. If support supplier files a writ petition regarding illegality or unconstitutionality, then he should also ensure that purchaser also joins him. That is because you have to also prove before the court that there is no unjust enrichment. From there, I will go to another reason regarding casual taxable person, which he has not covered. Rahul has not covered. See, casual taxable person has to pay tax in advance. Now, what these people are doing, after he pays the tax in advance, while granting registration, they don't, on flimsy grounds, they keep on rejecting. They reject, and thereafter, when it goes for refund, then online application he can't do. Now, this was a position till 2018. Thereafter, there was the amendment in rules, and he can apply manually. So, that is, that kindly remember it. Because, see, our members should also know that casual taxable person will also get refund, even if he doesn't get registration and online application is not, he is unable to make. Now next issue is 54.8. No credit to the consumer welfare fund. Now see, in every case, you have seen in VAT also, whenever there is a forfeiture, they try to credit it to consumer welfare fund. In fact, in many cases, the credit has not been given to consumer welfare fund. In one case, we applied for under RTI and getting the data from them. Thereafter, there was a lockdown. Therefore, I couldn't get the information. But in most of the cases, it has not been credited to consumer welfare fund. However, under the VAT, it was by rules. Now, here, the statute itself is saying, today or tomorrow we will apply under RTI and we will come to know how much credit they are giving it to consumer welfare fund. Now, but in some certain cases, they have said that it will be given to the claimant, refund will be given to the claimant itself. That is Clause A of Rule 58. Now, they are saying that zero rated supplies. Now this is substituted on 1-2-2019. Now see, earlier it was zero rated supply. The refund pertaining to zero rated supply. Now they have made an amendment and they are talking about export. Once they speak about export, then the sales and EOU are out of that, refund pertaining to that. So that is what now the question is, whether still they are entitled to the refund. They are entitled to refund, but they have to claim it under subclause E, not under subclause A. So under subclause E, they have to claim the refund, but under subclause E, they will have to establish that there is no unjust enrichment. They will have to lead evidence. This is the only difference after amendment. So that is another thing. Then we have casual tax. Any person we have covered. Then next is that circular which has been issued. Circular number 37 of 2018, dated 9-10-2018, where they are saying refund of ITC, so they are denying it. Now this is denying, now kindly understand, the denial is for the custom, drawback under customs. I don't agree with Rahul that it is the drawback of CGST, SGST or... It is a drawback of the circular clearly says it is a drawback under customs, and in two cases this circular has already been struck down. One is Gujarat High Court in Amit Cotton Industries SCA number 20126 of 2018, judgment dated 26-6-2019, and Madras High Court has also struck it down in Precourt Meridian judgment dated 19-11-2019 in WP number 20504 of 2019. Circular has been struck down, and that circular refers to drawback under customs and not this one. Under the third provision, you are entitled to if it is a SGST, IGST. I am thinking of writing an elaborate article on this issue, because this has to be challenged even in Maharashtra. So unfortunately, our Bombay High Court in so many cases, it does not agree with the other High Courts. Therefore, again, you have to get it challenged here and contest it. Now, next is composite supply. The composite, this is happening in Karnataka. It has been referred to us, therefore I thought it prudent to inform you this thing. See, composite supply, now department is getting the revenue on entire composite supply, including packing and forwarding this. But so in Karnataka, they are not giving the ITC the refund as regards packing and forwarding. So that is now... Karnataka has stopped doing that. Slowly, slowly, Maharashtra will also do this. They will start doing this. Now, see, this capital goods, I agree with Rahul, that capital goods, you are entitled to refund. You see, here the wordings are input tax credit. You can't take that input word alone. The input is also defined and input tax credit is also defined. So you have to take the definition of input tax credit and not input. So therefore, I agree with him. And I agree with him in this unmatched ITC also. Unmatched ITC, even if circular is silent, you will get that refund. You challenge it if it is denied. Now, this is what I feel the Rahul has not covered, and therefore I have commented on that. Now, any other question you can ask either Rahul or me. Rahul will answer it. If I am required to answer, I will also answer.
May I request?
Thank you. Yes.
there are some queries in the chat box. I request Rahul to please refer those queries and reply.
I'll just read out one of the queries. Okay, from Mr. Pravinder. So one multinational company having its headquarters outside India requires its Indian company to appoint some persons for internal audit of Indian company and report directly to the headquarters of the company, for which headquarters will pay cost plus 10% margin to Indian company. Whether the service provided by Indian company is export of service, particularly point number 5, the supplier of service and the recipient of service are not merely establishments of a distinct person. If place of supply is outside of India, of section 26 of the IGST Act, since the headquarters has full control over the management of Indian company and the internal audit would be done in India itself, and if the service is not export of service, whether the same would be exempted by notification of 2008 entry number 10F, since the recipient of service is located outside India and payment is received in foreign currency. See, the query is this, that there is a foreign company and it has a subsidiary Indian company. The foreign company requires Indian company to get its audit done and raise the invoice on the foreign company. The foreign company will pay 110% of the cost to the Indian company for this audit which is done of the Indian company. So whether this will be considered an export of service by the Indian company to the foreign company. Now if you see in the query also, yes, extracted, where the supplier of service and the recipient of service are not merely establishments of a distinct person. So in this case, if you are saying that multinational company and Indian company are establishments of distinct persons, I don't think so, because these are separate companies. If suppose I had a branch, the Indian multinational company only had a branch in India, that will be considered as an establishment, merely separate establishment of the distinct person. But as far as there are two separate companies, it cannot be considered as in a, and this clause will not come into picture. However, the question comes whether there's an export from India to the foreign company. In my view, I have a doubt, because the Indian company is not performing the audit on its own account. It is merely getting it done, arranging it for the foreign company by appointing some other auditor. Now, this is, again, I told you that intermediary service is a very tricky question. We have to go into the details of each and every clause in the agreement or the purchase order or whatever terms have been agreed upon. In this case, prima facie, I feel that Indian company is only acting as a conduit for the internal audit compliance of the foreign company. Indian company is not doing it for its own self. It is doing it for the multinational company for which they are appointing an auditor and getting it done. The price is entirely paid by the foreign company only. So this arrangement may fall under intermediary service, according to me. Chairman sir can give his inputs on this. Okay, now let's go to the next question by Neeti Savla. As you said, that exporter can file refund application for both zero rated and inverted rated supply, but portal don't allow refund application both category for the same period. So how is it possible? So simple, the circular also says so. You can file one of the applications either under inverted rated or under zero rated. The other application has to be filed under residuary category in any other case. There is a residuary column, residuary option of any other case that will definitely apply. I have personally tried it. So you can file it under that category, and then all the physical submissions have to be made, because under that category you don't have a detailed application. Everything has to be submitted before the officer physically. So under that category, it will two applications can be filed. Then another query is from Mr. Kunal Buddharaja. When an application for refund of ITC in case of export is rejected and credit ledger is again credited, there is no procedure to claim the refund of ITC for the same month again. Again, I would say that you will have to file it under any other category, because let's say you have applied for the month of January 20, that month is under that category is over. You cannot once again apply for January 20. But any other category, that is the last column, last option which is available, under that you can definitely file. Mr. Kunal also says that it was rejected. Then against that, you'll have to file an appeal if it is rejected. But as far as portal is concerned, it is allowing any applications to be filed under any other category. Now, last question we are seeing is, Mr. Rajesh Shirsat has asked the question, department has rejected refund on the ground that claim of CGST and SGST and part IGST instead of complete IGST first and then balance CGST and SGST. What is to be done in this case? So that master circular also clarifies, and the earlier circular also clarifies. Master circular clarifies that when a refund amount is arrived at, it is first to be adjusted from IGST, then in equal parts from CGST and SGST. However, if somebody has not done this, then the refund officer is given the authority to on the merits of each case to allow the refunds. They cannot reject it. In my view, in any case, they cannot reject it. Whether the circular is there or not, they cannot reject it because there is no law under the Act or the rules which say that you have to first utilize the IGST balance only for claiming refund. You can claim any order, and therefore the circular is there, but that circular is not binding. When it is against an SSE, this can be challenged in the court or in the appeal also. Question from Ms. Mitu. A legal firm is engaged in providing their services in India as well as out of India, that is exports. Firm is paying GST and RCM on import of services. In financial year 18-19, they have not applied for LUT and also not paid IGST on exports. Exports shown in GST 3B and GST 1 under exempt supply and not under export column. Total ITC for 18-19 availed in GST 3B of September 19. I 1920 exports made with LUT and correctly shown in GST 3B. ITC pertains to domestic supply have not been reversed yet. Whether firm is eligible to claim refund of ITC for financial 18-19? According to me, yes, they are definitely eligible for refund of ITC for 18-19. As I said, you can refer to that Bharti et al. Judgment of Delhi High Court, which says that 3B can be amended for that particular period to which the transaction relates. So when you are wrongly shown the export turnover as exempt turnover in the 3B, that should be corrected. Or you can follow the procedure under the circular of December 2019 also, that circular 26 of 17, December 2017 circular. If yes, what would be the last date for applying refund application for as per section 54? In this case, it will be export of services and pertaining to 18-19. Then you have to follow as per clause E, which says 2 years from the end of the financial year. Prior to 1st February 2019, that was the law. Then with reference to above case, what would be the relevant period under rule 89-4? Relevant period can be the entire year 18-19. Or it can be part of a year, or it can be quarterly, whatever you feel like. Now, the system is also allowing beyond one financial year. So, your relevant period can be January 20 to June 20 also. Earlier, this was restricted to a particular period within a financial year. Now, the CBIC via the circular 135 have clarified that it can go beyond a financial year also. Now, Ms. Manisha Dedia has asked, now they are restricting the ITC up to 2A and accordingly reduce the refund. But afterwards, when party file return, how can we claim that refund since one, the refund is filed? So, as I told you, the circular is silent on this. However, my suggestion would be you can claim that refund once again in your next period. Whenever you are filing your refund, include that ITC which was not granted in the earlier period in the next refund application and claim it. There is no other way out, or you have to file an appeal. That's the only way out. Then Pratik Kankaria has asked, the AR in case of Sapna Printing Works Private Limited, West Bengal, there it is held that printing service supplied to a person outside India, but delivery is in India and therefore not an export of service. His view is Section 13(2) IGST is considered, then applicant should consider the service as export of service. Your view, please. Okay, if printing is service and if it falls under the general rule of 13(2), then it can definitely fall under export of service because place of supply will be outside service. And all other conditions satisfied, the supplier located in India, foreign exchange, convertible foreign exchange is the consideration. And recipient is located outside India. Therefore, it will fall under export of services. That advance ruling I have not gone through in detail, but my view is that it can fall under service, export of service. Aditya Surte has asked one question, whether services of composing background score for a movie to be streamed online on Hotstar can be treated as an export of service when the billing is made on the production company based in Singapore. The movie will be available to viewers across Asia, including India. What would be the answer? Would the answer be different depending on whether the movie will be shot in India or abroad? I think a good detailed question. Now, I'll have to go through the provisions of online database retrieval system and all. Okay, so I can answer this question whenever you call me after this session.